Yes. You want to slow down the speed?
Slow it down and not be able to see.
Okay. So this is, for example, a random network. And the problem is because the probability is spread. We haven't seen it 22 parallel steps with the scale freedom. It doesn't reach that much. So it takes more time until an idea is diffused to the whole population. Okay? So that topology of interactions affects how we make decisions. It affects why we make certain decisions. You want to see the smaller? Obviously, if you do it enough times, as said, on average, small birds and scale-free networks diffuse things much faster. And that is again to say topology matters. Structural properties of a system matter. Human or natural. Obviously, an SIS model is what we've seen before was an SI model, so I wasn't susceptible again. So once I heard the rumor, I heard it. Or once I make my decision, or once I change my mind, I change it. I don't change my mind. Now here I'm susceptible again to other things. And that means that I don't get to this level all times. Actually, it's very hard for me to get to this level. And the main parameters affecting this type of model is the number of new infections I can cause, and the starting point. If it's single, if I'm the only one that thinks that way, or if there are more, if it's more than one person that thinks that way, and my importance on the network. Now, this is a bit different than our thought. The importance on the network is my centrality value. How many connections do I have? If I have a lot of connection, I'm central to the network, and I'm important. If I have one connection, I'm not important. However, it's not so simple. Because if I'm very close to somebody, and I can influence somebody that is very connected, then I'm very important, though I cannot see that. So we have a lot of complications when dealing with decisions in humans that we need to be aware of. Although we might not model it, we might not take it into account, we have to know it, because that's the limitations of what we're doing. And it's important to know the limitations of our models, I guess, no? And, for example, we've done a very simple experiment, 10 Facebook friendship networks, run an SIS model, 100 time steps, average 10 runs. Top nodes are identified by a combination of different statistical properties of networks. I know we haven't talked about this, but it basically is these are ways to see how important is a person within a network. Okay? And if you want to go into that, things we can talk later, I think. And what we found out is that if I have one random node, this is the percentage of people that will believe what I'm saying, or that actually change their mind, or in this case just infected. Three. So we have multiple seats, three people. But if I take the three top persons, everything changes. And there's a big difference here. Okay? So if I target the right individual, I might be able to trigger a change. That's a very positive thing. I don't think that's so easy, but in theory, if I target well, highly connected persons as initial seed, to try to make them change their behavior and to really buy into what we are telling them, then we might be able to start a viral marketing, or to start what is called viral marketing, to start this level, to start a change in the much wider population. Okay. And this is more or less all I had to say. Again, a reminder that multidisciplinarity is not transdisciplinarity. That if you make Japanese, Polish people, Caipirinhas, Bordeaux, Beer, and Kölsch, you might have problems, no? Your stomach might revolt.
But not Raghu.
But not Raghu. Raghu is very happy with this. And so, contrary to widely believed, multidisciplinarity is not transdisciplinarity and does not mean having a system approach. And that's there is always. We need not only transdisciplinarity but multi-methods, so models, experiments, and case study, and interactions between them at all times, while we're trying to develop in our understanding of these systems. And I hope you didn't really fall asleep too much. And I thank you for your attention.
I just have one comment regarding decision making. Yes. I think the best work and the tutorial of decision making, it's not an academic paper, it's not a book, it's the British TV series Yes Minister and Yes Prime Minister. This is right there. And this is like the world's masterpiece, I think from the 70s, and it tells you exactly how a parliament is run, how political decisions are made, and it's timeless because it's every generation it works the same. And without all the models, without all the equations, without all the graphs, you can understand how things really work in these closed meetings and the decision-making processes.
Are you able to then translate that and make it interact with the natural system?
Like with the outlet? I personally don't, but I guess one of you would.
No, we have to work together.
I own both of those series and watch them fairly regularly.
It is a funny show, but I think as scientists we want to get beyond this narrative of politics taking only 4 years, because politics doesn't work in vacuum. They do have to answer to people. So climate change and these issues are much more serious than those silly ideas of politics and 4 years. Because even older people make better decisions because testosterone levels and estrogen levels go down and assessment improves. So hopefully we are getting beyond this narrative that is repeated ad nauseum. I think so.
I believe we're good, but you notice that's always the older people that say it.
I like that, okay, because we shouldn't give up. Essentially, that's what they're saying. Science should continue. Will our politicians to listen or not? Because ultimately the population actually can make the politicians do the right thing.
There is some very nice work by Francis Wesley that talks about how you can actually change, trigger change. So you have to target the right politician because none of them are all the same.
And well, then, I live in DC and each politician has a group of 28-year-old ambitious people. You get in front of them, they will rip apart your science in 5 minutes. You think you're so smart. Be sure to be ready when you go first. Yeah, great. Okay. Any other comments?
So, say we think of the Earth's climate system as a network of complex interactions and regions, and then we think of an increasing CO2 as a disease that spreads through this network. How do you, and you know, when we think about the future projections, we worry whether we will reach a threshold where the change is irreversible. How important do you think that in this context we say that our climate system is scale-free or random? Would it matter?
It matters at the speed at which the change will happen. It matters a lot. If it's a scale-free network, once you get one of the hubs, then you're basically shifting.
And then we cannot go back to
The reversibility is a different question. I wouldn't know, I don't think. But there is also like some people, like a guy called Marty Andrews and Johan Rockström, they start to think that we should not think threshold anymore. We might should think about minefields. That is even worse. But that's a quite pessimistic view.
I mean, the hysteresis in the system is not. Both global warming goes in one direction, but the ecosystem can reverse or jump state, and there are hysteresis. So with these kind of analysis will evolve eventually to do that, but this is kind of a new science in some way.
Yeah.
you know, if we could go back to fishing, you know, we've removed the collet, but now just seeing it with the collet will not do much. We have probably removed some interactions to change the network, right?
We don't know, right? No, I mean, the salmon story tells you that in the 70s there was a ship and they thought it was caused by overfishing in the Northwest Gulf of Alaska. Actually, it was related to climate and they kept throwing billions of dollars into the water to bring the salmon. Conditions were just not right. So, learning the system helps. Any other comments? Okay, go take a photo and smile.